Hello and welcome. My name is Manuel Quintana, training manager here at Pragmatic Works. And in today's video, we're going to be taking a look at something that's been around within our Fabric workspaces for quite a bit, right? We're talking about the data science, data engineering, Spark pools. But there's been some recent changes now with how we could administer this at a more, just at a higher level. And this is going to allow us at an organizational perspective, right? Kind of across all of our Fabric workspaces to kind of dictate and control what pools will be available, standardizing what libraries are in there. This is just going to give us a little bit more control in an area where we probably need that instead of just allowing basically any pools to be created within any sort of workspace. If you're a workspace admin, we can rein that in. So we're going to talk about capacity pools. So let's go ahead, join me over in your browser of choice. We're going to check this out for ourselves. All right, so here we are. Same little workspace that we were working in a couple other YouTube videos ago. You can see, of course, my trial is getting closer. And the last video we did was talking about what to do with this trial expiration approaching us. Whether they extend or not, who knows? But you got to assume that. And for me, it's going to end in 7 days. And check out that video, because if you don't, you're going to lose whatever work you have in those workspaces. So check out that video. We kind of give some advice on what you can do to make sure you don't lose what you've got. But here, we're taking a different look. We're going to be looking at something that's been available to us for a while, right? If we go here, we're inside of this workspace and we adventure over to the workspace settings, we're simply going to find that we have an option under this data engineering and science area where we can go ahead. There's a starter pool that's available. You can make some small adjustments to this, like not too much really. Like you can just extend the auto scale capability. But usually you'll probably go through the process in your workspace settings and you'll actually potentially create new pools. So you can see there's an option right here. New pool, you literally go through the options. What's the name? What's the node? Right now we only have memory optimized, but you can choose a larger scale for maybe some additional more high priority workloads. And of course you're not limited. You can create like however, whatever pools you're interested in, however you would like it to be. Let's not forget, we also have this idea and concept of an environment here, which if you remember, well, I don't know if we've covered it yet, but environments were kind of something that was added a couple months ago to kind of separate. You have your pool, and then you can create libraries, or pardon me, environments, where you can set up, as you can see, shared libraries. You can specify the Spark compute that's going to be used. So you tie the pool to this, and you can specify within it what's going to be kind of the resources leveraged via that pool. So this is something that's still in play, and we're going to have to look at when we create what's going to be called a capacity pool. Because honestly, right here, all we have, if you have a workspace and you're an admin, you can create however many pools you're looking to do, right? You can do this. And this is per workspace, right? So there can definitely be some redundancy and effort here. This is going to obviously impact the usage and the impact against our capacity, right? As we have this capacity, we know there's resources. Yes, we have things like bursting and smoothing and like the new version of, if you will, auto scaling that comes with Fabric capacities, which is really cool. But sometimes we're going to want that little element of control, right? We want that ability and really an enterprise level to manage our cloud spending and, you know, pretty much optimize whatever compute resources. We want to make sure that's always a concern for ours, right? We're going to have these different roles. You're going to have your workspace administrators. You're going to have your capacity administrators. You're going to have your tenant administrators. And the capacity level, which is going to manage, you know, you may have one, you might have multiple capacities. That's going to be effectively the overarching view about around how we're using resources at that workspace level. So here we have this new ability inside of our capacity settings in which we can create capacity pools. And not only that, we can either enable, which it is on by default, or we can disable workspace level compute customization, right? So then that option that we just saw here, that goes away. This ability, when we go and look, if I go away from creating a new pool, right? And I go, you can see this drop down in a moment right here is going to be gone, right? We're just going to have the ability of just working with the starter pool. Our notebooks will have the ability of choosing between available environments. So that's going to be a caveat. But what we can do now is we can take the same process that we would have done as far as creating a Spark pool within a specific workspace. And we can go ahead and create this at the capacity level, right? So we can tell Spark how we want to adjust the number of nodes, depending on how much work we have. We can go ahead and create 2-3 of these. They're free. And as always, nothing changes here when it comes to the idea of kind of billing. You only pay when you run a Spark job against that pool itself, right? What happens is the Spark sets up nodes for you if we're using a notebook, and that's how it's going to be executing the code. But so billing doesn't change, even though we're doing this here. There is, at the moment, there's a small difference in the time that the capacity, like when we use a capacity pool, versus like a starter pool, it takes about 2 to 3 minutes for those settings to kind of take place. But other than that, everything else is going to remain the same. We just now control what pools will be available and how those resources are going to be leveraged at a capacity level. So naturally, all the workspaces that are assigned to that capacity will see this standardized option for using Spark pools. That's the idea behind it, just giving us that additional element of control. So where can we go to do this? Let's check this out, right? What we're going to do here is just head over into our admin portal. So naturally, we do have to have permissions to have capacity administration access. Even if you don't have tenant level settings like I have here, you just need to have access administrative to a capacity to see this little tab and, of course, see the capacity in question. I'm going to be performing this against my trial capacity right here. But of course, this is the same option that can be found in an actual fabric capacity. If you are paying, doing a pay as you go or a reserve pricing, you'll find that here, and you'll find the same options that we're going to discover as I'm going to be doing here on the trial. So I go to the trial for the workspace that we were just in, and we say, hey, you know what? I'm going to go ahead under data engineering and science. This is the new section. And I'm going to go ahead and create a capacity pool. And we're going to see the process remains the same, right? The only thing that's going to be new here is a little toggle that's going to appear at the top saying, do I want to permit workspace admins to size their own custom Spark pools based off of workspace compute requirements? So if I turn this off, that ability at the workspace level to create a new pool is now gone. But what I can do to make sure that we're offering them something maybe at a higher level of scale is I can go here and create a pool. We'll just say, I'll just call this capacity pool for full transparency. Let's say I'll make this a large pool. The one out of the box is a medium, so I'm going to create something that's a large pool here. And I'm just going to hit create. Very straightforward, very simple. We're turning off that ability. I'm going to go ahead and save this. So now this is all set, right? Now when I return to the workspace itself, we're going to see that I do not have any longer the ability when I go to the Spark settings to actually hit this drop down and do anything. You can see admin has disabled the customized pool. So we don't have that capability. So if I want now to have the ability, right? I haven't created any notebooks, but if I want the ability here, I can still do this at a workspace level to allow those notebooks, right? If I were to go ahead and just open up a quick notebook here and I want to take advantage of this capacity pool, we know here within the notebooks that we are leveraging, of course, these environments. So the only thing I have is my kind of default workspace settings, right? That's the only option that's being brought here to my attention when I take a look. So I still have to kind of go through the process now that there is a capacity pool available to create an environment. We can specify within this environment, of course, we'll just call this my capacity pool environment. You'll probably want to specify its capacity pool and maybe, you know, what was the actual settings for this compute itself. But I can say, you know, in this environment, I'm going to go ahead and leverage the capacity pool. So we can go ahead and set this. We can see you have a save value as invalid now. Min 1, max 9. So we can go ahead and that's set. It's just an odd thing. Those settings are correct. It's just a visual thing. And I can go ahead and save this. Of course, if I wanted to, I could add some additional libraries in here if I wanted to. YAML files, we can put that in. You can put in the configuration elements. But yeah, I can go ahead now and publish this environment, right? We're just going to go ahead and set this up. This pool is now tied to this environment, which is now going to be available for me to leverage inside of my notebook experience. So, but it's there, right? It's now something we can manage, we can maintain. The workspace side of things doesn't get to control the Spark pool, the actual settings of that pool itself. We control that as capacity administrators, and they simply leverage it as part of their environments. So they get to choose from a standardized list of options across all the workspaces tied to it, right? So once again, just administrative levels of kind of governance and control here to ensure that we're using kind of just a streamlined level of resources to ensure that capacity is being used as efficiently as possible. And you know, now when I go to the notebook experience, of course, we're going to have that option in the dropdown so I could take advantage of the capacity pool that was created here to run the Spark jobs, right? To run this notebook itself. So like I said, nothing really changing per se on how we create Spark pools. It's just where we create those Spark pools and effectively how we can kind of manage and administer this across our entire fabric tenant here, right? It's across that Power BI service, across all those workspaces. You can now have a little more control over what that process looks like. So definitely a heads up, a nice good thing here to add to our kind of administrative checklist. If we feel like that's something we want to control, if we know there's going to be heavy usage around that Spark, right? Spark jobs, notebooks, whatever it might be. We can kind of control the Spark pool settings this way. So now you've seen it, it's there. We might see some additional things come into play here, but something newly added to our capacity settings that we can work with. Well, hopefully you enjoyed, everyone. I'll see you in the next one.